اللهم صل على محمد.
And as we know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that the pleasure of Allah is in the obeying and the pleasure of the parents. But the anger, the sakhat, which is like ghadab, which is the anger of Allah, is likewise in angering the parents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been described with ghadab, anger and pleasure. Okay? Yani his happiness almost. Okay? His satisfaction, his pleasure with something. In the early times of Islamic history, when the sects started to develop in Islam and Islam started to split up into groups and so on, many of these groups did so based upon the understanding of these attributes and the names and these aqidah issues. Alright? And this is very important for those who try to safeguard the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah today. Because these sects have continued until today, understanding the attributes in a way that they understood it to be. And there's flaws, and we can see, for example, the Jahmiyyah, okay, a movement that was started by Jahm ibn Safwan. Now, this is a movement that were concerned, all right. And often these groups and these movements, they start off with people who are sincere in general about trying to preserve their aqidah, okay, or to trying to protect their izzah of Allah subhanahu wa taala. So this group, led by this person, Jahm ibn Safwan, they almost tried to propagate the idea. And when I say tried to propagate the idea, I mean there was a time of stability in the Islamic thought when the Salaf, and the Salaf refers to the Sahaba and those who followed them, the Tabi'een, and then those who followed them, the Atba' Tabi'een. The first 200-300 years, in fact, let's say 200 years, was pretty solid and safe and stable at the time of the Imams and the development of the key principles of Islamic fiqh and aqidah. But then, when Islam started to spread out and the borders started to increase and the different indigenous people started to be introduced and so on and come in, we find that in the introduction of such things such as Greek philosophy and ideas of rationale and logic, once that started to take place and take shape in the minds of the Muslims, we found that they, not only in their attempt to try and refute that and protect their aqidah, but at the same time, they took on some of these ideas. It obviously colored their mind. Just like today, just like our Islam today, it is very much colored by our exposure to the society and the people and the academics and the scientific mind. And that's why sometimes when we look at the Quran and so on, if our iman is weak, then we start to have these doubts about when we look at something and it seems to be scientifically non-true. And that's because we've been brought up in that kind of environment. And so it obviously affects. And so one of the effects that happened to the people like Jahm ibn Safwan and the Jahmiyyah group is that they said that, hold on, if you are going to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has anger, then you are trying to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like someone or something that has attributes, that he has, that he is murakkab, that he is composed of a self and a body. And therefore, if you're going to say that, then you're going to attribute that to him. And you can't do that because that's making tashbih. You are being anthropomorphic. You are trying to give a body to Allah. You're trying to humanize him. This was their kind of rationale. And it was a very deviant way of thinking. A great intention, maybe. But it was something which only the people of rationale and deviance actually started to propagate. Because there was no need for that to happen. What's the basis for this, by the way? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There is nothing unto like him. There can be nothing that can be compared to Allah. But he is السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. He is the all-hearing. He is the all-seeing. Okay? And so people trying to protect this principle, trying to maintain Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his purity, you would be worried if someone is saying that Allah gets angry. Hold on, are you trying to say that this Allah is trying to get angry like we get angry? Are you trying to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets happy like we get happy? You're humanizing him. You're making the mistake that the Christians did. You're doing this. You see this kind of thought. And so with this, what did they do? They said, you can't do that. And so they denied the attributes. They denied the attributes totally. And so they said, Allah, you cannot say that about anger, and you can't say that about happiness. And so therefore they would deny the narration. And this is the sunnah, of course. This is the sunnah, of course, authenticated from the Prophet ﷺ. So they would say this hadith is unacceptable. It goes against the principles of our aqidah. Okay? And then other groups did things similar, such as the Mu'tazila, the rationalists. Okay? They would do something very similar. They would look and compare the ideas that they were being propagated or even yani, told to them in hadith, and they would think about it. They would, yani, يقدم العقل النقل. The aql would come before the naql. They would use their intellect before the text. They look at the text and they say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets angry. How can that be? Anger is something which is so imperfect, so limited. You know, and so therefore they would say, no, that can't be the case. And so they, some of them would deny, and some of them would make ta'wil. Ta'wil means to reinterpret it and say, actually, his anger is not like this. Actually, it's his intention to become angry and not the actual real anger itself. And it starts to get really mixed up with playing around with the sifat, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was also then propagated by the Asha'ira, who then also started to make ta'wil of certain attributes. And then some of them started to make tafwil. Tafwil is to say that actually this has no meaning. Tafwil means to relegate something. So they would relegate the meaning to Allah. They say that the Prophet ﷺ, that he says that he has anger, he has sakhat, then only God knows what that means. Literally. We have no idea what that means. We cannot understand what sakhat means, because how are you able to interpret anger? How do you understand anger in relation to God? Things similar, such as the Mu'tazila, the rationalists. They were a lot closer to Ahlul Sunnah. They would say, no, we can't deny it because it's there in the hadith. We've authenticated the hadith. It's definitely a statement of the Prophet ﷺ. But we don't understand that, you know, and let's leave the meaning to Allah. So therefore, what's the problem with that? They're making the anger like the same as mercy, like the same as love, like the same as his punishment. They're not giving it a meaning. They're just saying it has no meaning. We cannot possibly think of anything. So then Ahlul Sunnah said, so what was the point of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then describing himself in this way? Why then did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then compare the anger and say that the anger of your Lord is in the anger of the parents? There has to be a meaning to it. And so now you can come closer to Ahlul Sunnah's position. And Ahlul Sunnah say to the rest of these sects, and they said from the beginning and they say it now, they stick to the word of the Sahaba. Don't put your head between a rock and a hard place for nothing. Why are you causing yourself such problems for? But look, the Prophet ﷺ said this, and let's just accept it. You know what ghadab means, I know what ghadab means. You know what sakhat means, I know what sakhat means. Let's not go into it and try to understand the kayfiyah and the exact nature of that. We understand what anger is, but we are not able to appreciate the exact nature of Allah's anger. But we know that He has anger, and we know that He is pleased. And we know, and this continues, this is just the two characteristics from this hadith. We know that He is astonished, as the Prophet ﷺ explains some hadith. And we know that sometimes He acts out of shyness. Now we can't understand this shyness compared to our understanding of shyness. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There is nothing unto like Him. And He is السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. So we have to remember this principle overriding the understanding of Ahlul Sunnah. We don't want to apply our understanding, our imperfection of the ideas of anger and attributes upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can see that the Asha'ira, they were saying, for example, hold on, how can you attribute the principles of anger? And what is anger? Anger is rage, and your blood starts to boil, and so on and so on. How can you say that Allah, His blood boils, and so on and so on? Ahlul Sunnah said, why are you attributing our understanding of the consequences of anger to Allah? This is illogical, and has no basis, and there's no need for you to do that. Because we are, the Asha'ira were told, they are effectively putting their understanding of the consequences of human anger upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can see, you can automatically, this, the area of aqidah is very delicate, very sensitive. And that's why Ahlul Sunnah followed a very, very beautiful way, a very safe way. They said that the way of aqidah should be the way of the Salaf, i.e. the way of the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, Atba' al-Tabi'een, who didn't delve into the kayfiyah, who didn't delve into the exact workings of these asma wa sifat, these names of Allah and His attributes, but rather they affirmed them. We affirm them. If the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like this, then we say Alhamdulillah, we accept it like that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Himself like so in the Quran, and then that is the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And which leads us then on, inshallah, onto the third hadith. And it's a new chapter, the second chapter, Babu Birrul chapter 2, being good to one's mother. And this hadith is narrated on the authority of the grandfather of Bahaz ibn Hakim. And Bahaz ibn Hakim and Abihi and Jaddihi radiyallahu anhu qultu ya Rasulullah man abar? Qala ummuk. Qultu man abar? Qala ummuk. Qultu man abar? Qala ummuk. Qultu man abar? Qala abak. Thumma al-aqrab fal-aqrab. And this hadith that has been narrated also by Imam al-Tirmidhi radiyallahu an, is something which is a narration which is hasan and acceptable. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Bahaz ibn Hakim's grandfather approached him and said to him, I asked the Messenger of Allah, to whom should I be dutiful? And he said, your mother. And he replied, I asked, then whom? He said, your mother. I asked, then whom? Your mother, he replied. I asked, then to whom should I be dutiful? He said, your father, and then the next closest relative, and then the next. The first thing that we see about this hadith is that we only have the name of Bahaz ibn Hakim, but as his full name, but we're not even told the name of the grandfather, because it is on the authority of the grandfather of Bahaz. But we know that Bahaz was at Tabi'i, and we know that Hakim was the famous Tabi'i Thiqa, and that his grandfather, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muawiyah ibn Hayda. Now, if you look at this hadith, and there's a narration that will come up later that will repeat this, and there's actually many other narrations similar to this hadith, we find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has emphasized the rights of the mother more so than the father, and more so than anyone else, because we know that the family comes first in our relations with society. And here the mother has been emphasized, and then the father, and then the family people, and then we know then the rest of the people will follow after that, as we will come to later on in the book. And it's actually an ijma' amongst the scholars of Islam that the mother takes priority of being respected, and her rights being fulfilled, i.e. to be good to her and to be kind to her takes priority upon the father. There's an ijma' upon that. Despite the fact that the scholars in the books of fiqh also say that the father has more right to be obeyed. His right individually is greater. His decision is greater. His command to you is greater. You have a greater obligation to obey him other than your mother. Yet the mother has a greater right to be shown ihsan and birr, and i.e. to be dutiful to her, to help her, to have kindness to her. And actually this is very clear from not just the hadith, especially here, three times the Prophet ﷺ mentioning again and again, and in other narrations more than three times, that the mother was more deserving of the birr of the son or the child. But this is clear in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانِ بِوَالَدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ in Surah Al-Luqman. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we have enjoined upon man to be good to his parents, he mentions parents, الْوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. And then what does he say after mentioning the parents? He said, حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ, his mother bore him in weakness and hardship. So after the parents, it is the mother who has been singled out as the one who has been, who has taken the hardship and gone through all the stress and the hassle that we know, that gives her this maqam. And actually we shouldn't be surprised by that, because the link between the mother and the child, everyone knows about that. No one needs to be taught about the link of rahmah and love that is specifically unique between the child and the mother. A link of mercy, a link of rahmah. And that itself is beautiful, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know, has told us to ask Him Azza wa Jal to have mercy upon the parents. And that's why the mother's womb, that place which we get our shelter and protection at the time when we're most desperate and in need for it, is called the rahim. It is called the rahim. It's from the same root verb as rahmah. So we can see the link. The rahim itself is where the child develops during pregnancy. And then when it comes out, it is the continual link of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the continual link of the mother to the child through rahmah, and an intense form of rahmah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبْرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَكُنْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْحَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جِنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. It's beautiful, the specific words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses in this ayah. And your Lord has decreed that you worship none but Him, and that you be dutiful to your parents. And if one of them or both of them attain old age in your life, say not to them a word of disrespect, nor shout at them, but address them in terms of honor. And lower unto them the wing of submission and humility through mercy. And say, My Lord, bestow on them your mercy, as they did bring me up when I was young. And this yani is almost a return of the rahmah that you have taken from her, that you have been cultured in. Her great role of giving you tarbiyah, that has almost natural to her. It's almost like the mother is a walking form of rahmah, based and centralized around the womb itself. Your home, what produced you, what looked after you, what protected you, what fed you. So when we understand this link, and then we understand then how important it is for us to appreciate birr in its correct way, and how to give the parents the right that they deserve. You can also see that this order in the hadith, by the way, where the Prophet ﷺ mentions the mother's right three times, and then compares it to the father on the fourth occasion. It's a 3-to-1 ratio. And we see that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ 30 شَهْرًا. I.e. and we have enjoined on man to be dutiful and kind to his parents. His mother bears him with hardship, and she brings him forth with hardship. And the bearing of him and the weaning is in 30 months. And so we can see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this hadith, by showing that yani, the mother and her right is given a 3-to-1 ratio to the father, is almost as if he is specifying these three stages which the mother specifically is particular to her only, this quality, this ability to do that naturally as the mother. She will get a reward, and she gets a right equal to that. The father cannot do anything in these three stages. He has no role in that. And so the mother cleans up in these areas. And if you look at these actions, the first, the action of pregnancy. And you know, I mean, if you're not married and you've not been able to observe this, then it's very difficult. But if you see the sickness and the tiredness and the difficulty that a woman goes through when she's pregnant with her child, and not just the difficulty, but the things that she has to give up, so many things that she enjoys that she has to give up. And her free time has to be now sacrificed. And she can't go to places that she'd like to, and she has to go through much difficulty. And then the giving of birth, I mean, subhanAllah. I mean, let me tell you something. No woman can ever understand and appreciate the pain of birth unless she gives birth herself. And then she understands automatically. And no man, okay, can describe that unless he sees it. Okay? If you haven't seen your wife give birth, then, you know, you just don't know what to talk. And let me tell you something, it's something which is absolutely incredible. And something totally ajeeb. And I still have a jacket, okay? When my wife gave birth to Isa, my eldest son, she grabbed my jacket so hard, and she, her fingernails dug into the material, and she ripped my jacket. And Twan is still there. I mean, it's a total good jacket wasted. And you know, honestly, I remember, because you know she was under gas, and she's screaming her head off, and you know she's got me like she's got why have I done? I don't know, but she had me with her hands, and she was like this, and I was being pulled in like this, and I'm, what am I doing here? And and she was not with me at all. She was on another planet altogether. She was screaming. You cannot imagine that moment and that pain. You can't. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recognizes it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recognizes it. And then you move on to the next stage. the stage of the weaning and the culturing and the bringing up of the child, the breastfeeding and the difficulties in that. Again, the restriction of lifestyle, the difficulties that one has to go. You know, I don't know if you can understand. People will tell you, or if you've seen it, the tiredness of the mother, the sleepless nights, how early she wakes up, and so on. And what makes it even worse is that often the husband is going to be sleeping right next to her, and in a different world altogether, doesn't know what is going on, absolutely innocent, just doesn't care, or hasn't got a thought in the world for what's happening right next door. And the mother is going through so much stress and hassle and pain. And so here, these are three things which are specific to the mother. And that's why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has mentioned her three times. And then we start to reach parity now. Or do we? Because then the father now starts to take his position of tarbiyah. But it's not like as if suddenly he takes over. How many fathers do you know that once they're you see that as Allah says, 30 months Allah mentions in the Quran. 30 months is equal to 2 years of weaning and a minimum pregnancy of 6 months. Okay, that's very important because obviously 9 months is the normal pregnancy time. But the Quran, and that's a miracle itself by the way, in the Quran, that it shows that it's possible. The Quranic worldview understands that a 6 month pregnancy is a viable pregnancy and a viable child is produced. And this ayah has very important ramifications in the rulings of zina. Okay, and the rulings of giving qadha, of judging against cases where people come, you know, to give you a very brief example, if a couple get married and 6 months after the day of marriage, there's a child. So automatically you're thinking, astaghfirullah, what's happened here? Right? 6 months? I mean, it should be 9 months, right? And Ali radiallahu an, if I remember correctly, gave qadha. And he ruled in favor. And obviously, this happened, and the father said, "You know, you've done zina, all right? And then you married me. You know, how can I have had a child within 6 months, at least 9 months or 10 months or something? How straight away?" But the Ali radiallahu anhu gave qada at that time. Don't think about our scientific advancements now, where we can work out dates and blah blah. No, that was at that time. Ali radiallahu anhu said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that her weaning is 30 months, 30 shahra, which means we know that from the other fisaluhu amin, in the other ayah that we mentioned last session, that the weaning is in 2 years, but this one, which is 24 months, but here it's 30 months, which means that 6 months must be the pregnancy itself. And so therefore, if Allah says that a pregnancy of a child can be 6 months there and then 2 years afterwards, 24 months afterwards, therefore it means that the 6 month child is viable and this child actually is yours. And so he ruled against the husband and they were happy with that. So then, you know, this shows that some of the ayat can be used in such a very deep sense by the scholars of fiqh when they're making qada and judgment. But as I said, these three things, these three qualities and characteristics, they're specific to the mother. But then the father doesn't suddenly come and take over and do everything. The mother herself then plays an equal role in spending upon the child and feeding the child and clothing the child, you know, throughout the rest of the years. In fact, more so than not, the mother does much more than the father. The mother does much more than the father, even at this stage. And as we said before, the role of tarbiyah, the key role of parents, okay, to make this child cultured and bring them up in a way to get the golden objective achieved, which is that the rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is understood and achieved and affirmed by the child. The mother is the one who is responsible for that. The mother is not, they say, just that she, behind every great man is a great woman. But behind every great nation is a woman. Because the woman is absolutely key. The mother is key in developing these characteristics and these emotions and the behavior of a child that he or herself will not only recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the greatest of purity, but then be able to interact with the rest of society to make it a real community, a real nation. And that's the maqam of the mother. The ulama also mentioned, and again, Ibn Hajar radiallahu anhu, he precedes everyone in that, in mentioning some of the other reasons why the mother is more emphasized almost, or why the Prophet ﷺ exaggerated more in the haqq, in the right of the mother over the father. One of these reasons is that, you know the mother, right? Your relationship with her, your closeness to her is always behind, behind closed doors. It's in the house, it's out of the way of the people. People do not see your day-to-day interaction with your mother, but with your father is very, very different. Your father by nature and by his going to the masjid and going to work and so on is very much outside the house, but the mother is always inside the house. And this itself, yani, as you well know, means that you can get away with a lot more against your mother than you can with your father. And so often because of that, her rights, okay, the children almost get a greater audacity almost to try and pull off acts against their mother of disobedience and being rude and so on, that they would not be able to do against their father. Not just because the father is stronger, but just basically because he's in front of the people. You know, you know that is a very silly thing to try and do something with your father and then go and meet him with your friend. He will do your bestie publicly. He will really embarrass you in front of someone. I mean, forget about the whole idea of it being a sin, but he can come and he meets an uncle and you're there, and then your uncle will say, you know, he's a good lad, your son, and then really? He does this and he says that and he does this, says that, and then you tell him and then you tell the shopkeeper and then you're telling him, you're thinking, oh my God, why did I come out with you in the first place? Just to be just slated. And that's the nature, isn't it? It's the nature of our tabi'ah to do that. And also we know that the mother herself, by her nature, she's a lot more softer, a lot more weaker as well. And that makes her more vulnerable. And unfortunately it makes her almost more vulnerable to contempt on our behalf, on our side. And when someone has that contempt, they find it easier to establish authority and to be more forceful with someone like that. And that's another problem. And again, so therefore the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who is almost trying to recognize that inequality in the relationship, and then trying to defend that principle, trying to defend the principle that the mother is already disadvantaged compared to the father, and so we need to now make it up, to make her emphasize her right even more. Not only do we see this weakness, and recognize it, but also its effect upon us makes us worse. How? We know that the mothers, we all do, because our biggest problem, if you ever wanted to see a major source of the lack of blessings and problems, you know, amongst our community, amongst the Muslims, it is because we mistreat our mothers, okay? And we do it so easily. And you know, they don't help us. They really don't help us in this action. Because their nature is, because of their weak nature, because they're so soft, they get angry very, very quickly, because their love for the children is more than the normal love that can be seen. It's very intense. And they get very, very upset. Very upset at little things that you do. They're very, very close to you. And sometimes, you know, we cannot appreciate that. And what happens often is that they cry a lot. And we know that mothers cry a lot. That's by in her nature. And we know that they get very angry. And we know, and how many times have we heard the du'as against us. Day and night making du'as against us. And they never mean to, but they go away and saying this and saying that, whatever. And that's because of her nature. And then that caused the child to become angry. You know, and it's often without any good reason. You do something and suddenly she will just go off and you think, SubhanAllah, what have I done? What's happening? And so then that causes a greater sense of contempt almost, and a greater sense of anger in the child. And they try to then push that off, and then, you know, it almost becomes a vicious circle, gets worse and worse. And we're all guilty of that, everyone. And so here the Prophet ﷺ has recognized this anomaly, recognized the nature of the woman, and therefore emphasized, if it wasn't already enough in the Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, after worship him, be good to the parents. Not only making it from the absolute individual obligations, not only as we come to see making disobedience to them from the kaba'ir, from the deadly and the major sins, okay, but then in our own understanding, the Prophet ﷺ in a more subtle way is saying, she has more right to be treated good. She has more right that you be dutiful to her. She has more right for you to have more patience with her. That we understand these weaknesses and these problems. Because if we do, then we now know not to fall into the trap. We now know that, okay, this is how she is, but she can't help some of these things. We should recognize that. And you know, the Prophet ﷺ recognized that, so why can't we recognize that? So then once you understand these kind of characteristics and you appreciate that more, then we can hopefully be able to make the haqiq and achieve our goal of giving her more love and more concern and more kindness and so on. And her maqam, of course, you might say, you know, really is her maqam, her status, really deserving of such a high pressure upon us to maintain? And of course, there's no doubt about that, yani, one little bit. right? And we have a very famous narration from Ibn Umar, the narrator of the previous narration, when he was sitting in the haram, and a man came making tawaf, okay, with his mother on his back, okay, and he came to Ibn Umar and he said, you know, have I fulfilled my right to my mother? And Ibn Umar said, لا ولا زفرة. You have not even done a zafra. And you know what a zafra is? A zafra is, in this narration, it's the sound, it's like a moan, it's the intake of breath, okay, during labor, okay? So your making tawaf hasn't even reached the level of one of them sounds that your mother went through while she was giving birth to you. I mean, you know, if you think about that, this is a, you know, a beautiful, yeah, a graphic illustration of the right of the mother upon us, so that we can appreciate how much we need to give her birr and how much that we are deficient in giving her birr. I mean, today, subhanAllah, look at our society, look at our people. We take a shopping, we think that we've saved the world. We take to the corner shop and we think we've done the whole world a favor. And you know, we're talking about Hajj and Tawaf, right? Yeah, people think, right, I'm going to take my parents to Hajj as they've done some huge, yani, big action. And then, you know, oh, my mother's old, so I'm going to take her in a wheelchair. And you know, people say that, right? And they probably say it because they don't realize what they're doing, what they're saying. I took my mother around, I did a Hajj or Umrah with my mother in a wheelchair, right? And they probably paid someone else to do the wheeling as well, right? And they make it out like to be a big thing. And they should read this narration. I mean, listen, try carrying her on your back, make the tawaf, and then realize that you haven't even repaid back, yani, that one little sound that your mother actually experienced and she made when she was going through the pains of giving birth to you. So subhanAllah, her maqam is something which really is very difficult for us to understand. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, in the authentic narration, said that, yani, be at her feet. فَثَمَّ الْجَنَّةِ, for paradise is at her feet. You'll find paradise there. It's there. If you want to get to Jannah, you'll find it at the feet of your mother. You'll find it in her service. You'll find paradise by obeying her and keeping her happy. Why? Because only the one who is able to make absolute perfect tahqiq, okay, absolutely perfectly achieve keeping her mother happy, that kind of person will be a person of paradise. That kind of person, that kind of quality, will be a person of paradise. And that's all, you know, that we have time for, inshallah, in this session. And hopefully we'll complete the hadith in the next. Wa jazakum Allah khair wa subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka Allahumma wa atubu ilayk.
اللهم صل على محمد